Welcome back. In this video, I installed the new Starlink DC power supply, perfect for off-grid and RV installations. So, in our last video, I took the standard Starlink RV kit and converted the motorized base to a fixed flat mount base and mounted it on our rooftop. If you haven't seen that video, you can click the link up here and check that out. But in brief, I cut out the section of the dish that holds the motors and 3D printed a cradle socket that holds it to our rooftop, and using some aluminum brackets to interface to our roof, have it mounted there so that we don't need to set up and tear it down every time we go for a drive. And it's been very nice and heartwarming to get messages from other people who have taken and printed that base as well, and have it now on their rooftop too. So anyway, being flat mounted on the roof means that we don't need to set it up and tear it down every day as we continue on our journey. Not to mention, we have in motion data while traveling. So this has been very, very nice in Ecuador and moving northeast through the Amazonas region now into southern Colombia. But before we get into this video too deep, I'm going to answer some of the most commonly asked questions from our last Starlink video. The number one question, does the app still work? And I can understand why you'd wonder. We did cut off the wire to the Starlink router, and so people might assume that all of the brains of the operation are handled inside the Starlink router. In fact, everything's handled inside the dish. So yes, the app works perfectly fine. You can go through, see all the statistical data, the throughput, speed tests, the obstruction map, debug data, everything you want still works. You can go into settings, there's the snow melt and the sleep schedule, all that. The only difference is that the settings related to the Wi-Fi, SSID and password are grayed out, and that's because all of that is now handled by our internal router. And interestingly, the app still starts with the graphics showing the Starlink router and the dish at an angle, but once it's connected to the Starlink network, the dish goes flat and the router disappears. So clearly it knows that we've flat mounted the dish. Now, because we turn off the power to our Starlink at night, just to save some energy, the obstruction map is almost never populated because it takes several hours to map the sky and to find the obstructions. So in our obstruction map section in the app, it's usually not present until midday after it's been on for a few hours. Then it can see the obstructions in our area. For us, it's not such a big deal because we move so often that a little bit of an obstruction, it's going to be different tomorrow and different the day after that. And so it doesn't matter for us, but worth noting that if you power it off and power it on every day, you're not going to see your obstruction map. But interestingly, the dish is also portrayed flat, pointing straight up in this interface here as well. Another very common question, does it work while we're driving? For us, through Ecuador and Colombia, yes. This might be different in other countries with different laws, but for us it works. We don't seem to have any restrictions for how fast the vehicle is moving or the speed that we're going. But to be fair, we're not downloading massive files or streaming to concurrent 4K streams or anything like that. We just need it for normal navigation, streaming some music, WhatsApp messages, that sort of thing. I did notice when we were driving through jungle canopy with some trees overhead, that does slow it down. We were getting maybe 40 or 50 megabits per second during some of the speed tests I ran. And when it's raining, of course, that canopy gets really wet, and then that interferes with Starlink quite a bit. So we're down to 5 or 8 megabits per second, but that's still more than usable for normal driving activities, navigation, that sort of thing. Next question. Do you have that bell on? The reason I ask is if you watch our videos in the first 48 hours after they're released, you don't see any of the video advertisements. I don't think our loyal viewers should be put through advertisements watching these videos. So make sure you have that bell on and set to all. That way you can see our videos as soon as they come out without any ads. Thanks so much. Next question. Is it still fast? Did it affect the speeds to cut the leg off and mount it flat? And that's a good question, and I thought it was implied because I demonstrated that I did a whole bunch of testing beforehand, and then I went through with the modification and did it. So it seems to me that it would be obvious, but yes, it's still just as fast. As you can see in these historical speed tests from my speed test app, we're getting well over 250 megabits per second a lot of the time, always over 200 with it flat mounted to the roof. And just in case someone thinks I've fabricated this screen with fake images, I've linked to the original speedtest.net results in the description. You can go and scroll through some of those if you like. So I did get some comments and saw some other reports online of people who have done the exact same modifications and are getting really horrendous speeds. And while it is easy to blame the PoE injector for your 10100 speeds, it's much more likely to be the RJ45 crimps. Now, I didn't mention this in our video, just to save time, but I actually had four bad crimps while making that video. Seven of the eight connections were connected, and there was one that didn't connect properly. And even though I've crimped hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of RJ45 connectors over the years, Starlink uses a very fine stranded cable, and it just wasn't making connection. And so if you're having some problems, that's the first thing to check. In fact, I was so sure that the crimps were good and that it wasn't my fault, I took the PoE injector and cut the case open, expecting to find a poor solder joint on the RJ45 on the board, or something, you know, burnt or damaged, or fake components, fake pulse converters, something to explain my problem. In the end, it was a bad crimp, bad connections on the RJ45s. So if you're getting less than 10100 speeds, less than 100 megabits per second, and you don't know why, that's the first thing to check. Even the coupler that I first used, it was really slow all of a sudden after I did the conversion, and I had to swap out to a different coupler because the first one had one of the pins bent over sideways, and that was causing the speeds to be horrendously slow. So that big long spiel just to say, if you're getting slower than expected speeds after making the conversion, check your RJ45 crimps. They're cheap, just do them over again. So anyway, let's get to the point here. In our last video, I showed how we installed the Tycoon PoE injector and one of these generic aluminum boost converters that takes the 12 volts and boosts it up to the 48 volts needed to power the rooftop dish. But this method requires crimping non-standard X-swapped connections onto the Ethernet cable, and that seemed to confuse a lot of people, and it was a little bit of a DIY cobbled together looking solution. Then my very best friend in the whole wide wide world sent me a message and said, hey, have you seen this new Starlink power supply for RVs? And I was like, what? So I checked it out, and sure enough, it's a fellow Canadian in Nanaimo, British Columbia, and he's designed a DC to DC power supply with PoE injector all built into one unit. So I sent him an email and say, hey, can we get one of these for our upcoming videos? And he was like, you betcha. Like I said, this is a brand new product design, and they'll have production volumes ready to ship in March 2023. So by the time this video goes live, you should be able to get in your order. They sell for $125 Canadian, which is about $98 US. And in addition to that, he's given us the promo code Everlanders, which you can use for an additional 10% off your order. So that'll work out to about 88 Freedom units. Now, because I started filming this video in February, this is actually a pre-production unit, so the production models will be slightly different, but effectively the exact same size and do the exact same thing. So let's go over one of these real quick. I'll show you all the connectors and what they do. On the left side here is the DC power input. This will accept anything between 10 and 30 volts, so that's perfect for either a 12 or 24 volt system, common in automotive and RV environments. It's also reverse polarity protected in case you've connected the power wires backwards, or if the vehicle saw a reverse polarity spike for some reason while you're boosting or something crazy like that. Then there's a 10 amp input fuse here. It's a very common mini ATC size. Then above that is the remote shutdown connector. So if you wanted to tuck this whole thing away in a cabinet or stash it somewhere, you could run thin wires from here to toggle switches. and then use those to power it down remotely or shut it down at night to save power, whatever you want. But if you just leave these unpopulated or disconnected, it'll power up and run as usual. Then over here on the right side, we have the RJ45 connections. The top one goes to your router, and below that, this one runs to Dishy. And it's very important not to mix these up, because you'd be sending 48 volts straight into your router, which of course would let out all of the magic smoke. And then one more connector here. This is the 48 volt auxiliary output, which is used to test them under load during production. I'm not sure what you'd use that for, but if you want to power something 48 volts, it's there if you want it. And then right here next to the Dishy's port is the power indicator LED, which glows red when the dish is powered up. It's a very nicely put together board with some nice design decisions that ooze thoughtfulness. Equal length traces here for the data lines for impedance matching. There's a location marked here where you can cut this trace and disable the LED if you'd like, and reconnect it with a solder blob to re-enable it. There's similar jumper pads up here to change the polarity of the pins for the router's PoE power. But in our case, the MoFi 5500 doesn't use PoE at all, so we can just pull this fuse here, which will disable router PoE injection entirely. These are being offered as PCBAs, just like this, but you definitely want to get a case for it, because this is pumping 12 volts up to 50-ish volts, and if you were to grab it the wrong way, it's going to tickle. And while they do offer an aluminum extrusion style project box for $50, I thought it would be a really nice idea to whip up some 3D modeled designs, which can be 3D printed, and share those freely with the community. So this is what I came up with. It's a compact, clean, austere design that can be printed without supports. Then to jazz it up just a bit, I made two more versions where I've printed the logo on the print bed first in Everlander gray, and then I come back and print white and print the rest of the case on top of that. So the logo is just printed two layers deep, and it's sliced so that it prints super slow and has nice sharp edges with good bed adhesion. And then the second job needs to be aligned in the slicer so that it prints in the exact same place and the logo lines up perfectly with the embossed logo in the case. You just need to make sure you have your Z-hop enabled to retract on to hop on retract and set that to 0.5 or 0.6 millimeters, and that will cause the nozzle to lift up over the logo as it's printing the case on top. If you have a probe bed leveling set up, you'll want to make sure to disable automatic bed leveling so that it doesn't probe off of the pre-existing logo. And here are the results. I printed one with the Dishy DC Koala Bear logo and the second one with the Starlink logo. Gave them a quick sanding and a quick spray of clear coat. And if you squint and set your YouTube player resolution to 240p, I'd say they look pretty good. I designed this little hood scoop in here to catch the light from the surface mount LED and reflect it 90 degrees out of this little hole. And then I used some silver chrome colored paint I have around here for touching up various things, and covered this area all with the silver paint just to keep the LED light from bleeding through and causing the whole case to glow. When I designed the case, I made provisions for M3 threaded brass inserts to be heat pressed into the screw holes, the screw bosses in the corner of the case. But in practice, when you install the circuit board, the connectors really click into the holes on the side and it holds it in there really well. So I doubt that the threaded inserts are even needed. So for a little bit of a cleaner look on mine, you probably noticed that I removed the 48 volt auxiliary output connector and omitted the hole on the case that I printed, but I have included both versions of the case in the design files. If you're interested to print out such a case, they're freely available on thingiverse.com. The link is in the description. So to close in the back and to mount it to the wall, you'll need to print out one of these back plates, and it has four screw positions for flexibility to mount it however you'd like. And then the top and the bottom have snap hook features, which match the snap groove features in the case. So it just clicks on there. So to install it, you just screw your plate to the wall and then snap the front of the enclosure over that for a nice clean install. So there it is, ready to install. Installation is dead simple. Just get your Starlink cable, run it to a reasonable length and cut the cable, and then crimp on a standard T568B configured RJ45 connection. No need for fancy X-swapped cables here. Then you just take that connector and plug it into the Dishy port on the side of the Dishy DC power supply. You're also going to need to make yourself a short little patch cable. This is just straight through conventional T568B on both ends, and that plugs into the router connection, and the other end obviously into your router. Lastly, you need to supply DC power, either 12 or 24 volts, and just make sure your wire gauge is sufficient for the power consumption. I think here I've used 12 gauge, but you want to make sure the wire is thick enough, especially if you're using the snowmelt feature. And that's it. Dishy will assign your router a DHCP IP address, and you're online. I've been testing this unit out for the last few weeks and have had zero issues. It's running cool as a cucumber, even inside this case. The dish just powers up, locks onto the network in about a minute, and the speeds are as fast as ever. 250 megabits per second is not uncommon, even though it's flat mounted on our roof. It's a really nice solution for Starlink in an off-grid or RV camper environment. Whether you still have the motors or not, if it's flat mounted, or if you need the snowmelt feature, this will work just fine. If you're interested in such a PoE injector with built-in DC power supply, check out the Dishy DC at boondocker.io. And if you decide to order one for yourself, use the promo code EVERLANDERS when you check out and get 10% off. Link in the description. A massive, massive thank you to Matt and the team at boondocker.io for sending these samples out to us, and for the discount code for you fine folks. And an even massiver thank you to Furious George. He's our Elon tier member, putting up the pesos this month for our Starlink service, so thank you very much. As always, a big thank you to all of our supporting channel members, Matt and Levi. It's the support of these guys that let us make the videos we want to make and not shill for big VPN. Binary Buddha, Boxer Metal, Derek, great people, legendary folks. Remember to turn on that bell to watch all of our future videos without advertisements, and whether you're a member or not, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time. It's a Starlink video. The next video is a Starlink video. It's a hack.